And so the key to that, Brenda, is looking to Jesus in every situation of our life, because that can be like a raging sea. It can change with every moment. And the happenings of life, I'm telling you, they can bring you happiness one moment and sorrow the next moment. But those that know the Lord, keep their focus on Him, have a constant joy, that they can carry with them through life. It's an inward confidence, a peace that comes from just walking with the Lord, going from glory to glory to glory, ever being changed. So I want to talk about the joy of the Lord. And I think God is a lasting joy. We see that even 2 years after Jesus was born, 2 years after, this joy is still permeating the atmosphere and the world. We had some wise men in Matthew chapter 2 that were journeying, and they've been journeying for about 2 years. They'd seen a star the day that it was born, and the star began to lead them far from the east, and maybe over 1,000 miles they traveled following the star, and they came into Jerusalem, and the king asked to speak with them when he seen this big parade of wise men coming in. It was more than three, probably 30, maybe 300, we don't know, but it was probably more than three, because it got the attention of the entire community as they came into Jerusalem, and they said that they were following the star was leading to a king, and this king was going to be born in Bethlehem, because that's what the word of God said. And so they were following the star, and somehow the star must have stopped there in Jerusalem, I guess, for this time with the king, and giving him an opportunity to rejoice with what God was doing. But how many know that some people don't rejoice at Christmas time? They're not ready to receive the King. But joy begins when you are ready to receive the King.
Amen.
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 That's the first thing I want to get across to you, is these wise men came all the way from the east because they had a desire to see the King. Not only to see Him, but to receive Him into their life. And that's where they journeyed all that way. And so when they came, and they were kind of shocked to see that here was a king that outwardly acted like he wanted to see the king, this child born in the manger, but his inward desire was to destroy, because he saw the king as a what? A threat to his throne, a threat to his position, a threat to his comfortable life. So right away we see the wise men detecting what was going on here in their lives and in the life of this king. And these wise men realized that joy goes deeper than just a promise. It goes deeper than just a purpose. It goes deeper than it. Real joy is in a person. A personal relationship. They were on a journey to meet the King. They were on a journey not only to meet Him, but to receive Him into their life. And if you receive Christ as King of your life, I'm telling you, He will provide you the joy that you're looking for in all of life. And in the same way that your body craves food and exercise and rest, so your spirit can only be satisfied with one thing, and that is with Jesus Christ. And you can seek for joy in every other thing, but until you find Christ, you will never have the joy of the Lord, which is the fullness of joy that God wants us to have. If not, everything is like a dark hole inside us, and you just keep filling it up, and the more you try to fill it up with money and power and prestige and everything. In fact, all the wise men, they came with all their gold, they came with their frankincense, they came with everything they had. They were saying, Lord, we realize it's not in this. We're ready to give it to you. That was what drove them. Something realizing we have tried all these things, and we've had pomp and power and position and wisdom and everything else that we can have in life, but there's something lacking. And believe me, in every heart, in every man and woman and child around this world, if they don't know Him, there's a dark hole that cannot be filled with anything less than the eternal God through Jesus Christ,
amen,
our Lord.
Amen. wise men taking a 1,000-mile journey just to meet him, just to see this child. Hallelujah. And it gives me hope that there's going to be a lot more wise people out there in this world that eventually are going to come to know whom to know is life eternal. Jesus Christ. Harold, he was so afraid of his position and power and everything. Do you know that he had three sons and he killed all three sons? He killed them because he was afraid they would take the throne from him. This guy was wicked and evil. And that's what this world becomes without Christ. Amen. Becomes confused and messed up and disappointed in life. It loses all of its purpose and everything else. And they become a disgruntled, hateful, mean people. You know why people walk into schools and shoot and kill the other little kids? You know why they do that? Because they have no joy. Their life is so messed up because they left Jesus Christ out of it. All their life then leads them on a road of darkness to the point they cannot even see straight. They can't think straight. Their life becomes so messed up that they do hideous, horrible, evil things. And the only explanation for it can be this: they don't have a clue who Jesus Christ is. It's sad. That's why gun control and every kind of, you can't put control on hatred and evil and all. You can't put a law that stops that. No. There's only one thing that can stop the evil and the hatred and the bigotry and the prejudice and the racism and everything. There's only one thing that can stop that, and that is the love of God in our hearts. You meet your brother, you meet your sister, you meet this world, and you're ready to give them a great big hug. Your heart's overwhelming. And I'm telling you, one of the marks of God's people ought to be a joy, unspeakable, and full of glory, Peter spoke about. Amen? And I love that. And so, when you receive the King, the moment you receive Him, brings joy. Not just joy, it brings great joy into your heart. And what lets me know it's a lasting joy. This joy had been going on from when Christ was born. It's 2 years later, and this joy is still just permeating. It's in the air. It's in the atmosphere. And anyone that gets around this Jesus, I'm telling you, this is 2,000 years later, and the moment somebody gets in the presence of God, there's a joy. There's a presence of God that's unbelievable. And again, I said, the hope, the joy, a peace, a love, all these powerful things begin to happen in our hearts the moment we get in the presence of the King. And so I love this. But not only when we receive the King, but when we go a step further and not just receive Him, but we allow this Jesus to reign in our life. And in Matthew chapter 2, it's so beautiful. When they come to this King, the Bible says there that they came and they bowed down. It says this in verse 9. When they had heard the King, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And then they brought their treasures, the gold, the frankincense, and the myrrh. They were symbolically saying, Lord, not only do we receive you, but we're going to receive you as our King. We're going to bow before you, and we are going to let you reign over our life. We have been reigning over our life to this moment. We have been making our own decisions, going in our own direction, doing what we want. But today, we want you to reign in our lives. One songwriter said it this way, Jesus be the Lord of all. Jesus be the Lord of all. Jesus be the Lord of all, Lord of all. For if He is not Lord of all, He is not Lord at all. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I love this. All their time, their treasures, their talents, their trust, everything, even their tongue. James said, if you can give God your tongue, He's got all of you. It amazes me how much, how much we give to God, but Lord, when it comes to us giving Him our tongue, and letting God take control of our tongue, it's so hard, you know? And He can rule and reign over so much of our life. Some of it's our wallets and our giving, and we're pressured by that. It seems like we just can't find the ability to let Him reign over everything in our life. We love to receive Him as a babe born in the manger, but we don't let Him reign over our life like He wants to. One man said this: joy is the byproduct of obedience.
Amen.
One man said to me, I still have no joy in my life. How can I have this joy? He said to me, Brother Roy, how can I have this peace, this joy that I see in your life? I said, it comes by obedience. These wise men had been walking in obedience for 2 years, walking on this journey just to find this gift from God. They had heard about it, they had read about it in the scriptures. Now they were being led by this marvelous light in the sky. How it was leading them, only God knows. As the star moved across the universe and led them at that special moment in their life to this Christ child. But what I want you to get here is every step of the way they were being obedient in faith, walking, following after God, till they found that child. And that takes obedience. And I'm telling you, you will never have fullness of joy until you learn to obey. Amen?
Amen.
They were willing to bow down and say, Lord, here is our gold, representing all the wealth of this world, everything this world can offer to you. Gold was the most precious commodity at that time on the earth. They're saying, here, you can have our gold. You can have all the frankincense, the sweet things in this life. And so many, we can give God everything, but we can't give Him our football. We can't give Him our TV. Can't give Him our movies. We can't give Him our entertainment. We can't give Him any of that sweet stuff that we enjoy every day. Oh, no. We can't even give Him up a little bit of food. Lo and behold, if God spoke to you in heaven and said, don't eat tomorrow, God, I guarantee you 99% of us would be disobedient. We just, because food has become our God. And we, to give up our frankincense, those sweet things that we have, how do you know in America we have a lot of sweet things? It's everywhere through the entertainment and the industry of food and fast food and everything else. I remember driving home in dark Africa, being a long journey, about several hours from the capital city to get back home. And I mean, going down these, I mean, dark. You don't know what darkness is until you get in Africa. There's no street lights, no electricity, it's dark. And especially when it's not a full moon, and it's so dark you can't see your hand in front of you. That's how dark it is. And I mean, just driving, I come to a small village with all these little lights burning. I think, oh God, anything for McDonald's. Sell my soul just for one hot cup of coffee. We have so much in America. It's so hard to sacrifice our frankincense. These sweet, sweet things we have all around us. That's why we begin the new year. All you that might be coming for the first time, we begin our new year from the 10th up until the end of the month of January in a time of 21 days of fasting and praying and seeking the Lord. And some will do a partial fast and fast different things, but some will go on a complete fast and just fast before the Lord and seek God. I think to me it's one of the greatest times of the year for me to enter into that year, just spending that time focused on the Word and focused on God. And I'm telling you, it was a time when Christ can really get a hold of your life and begin to take over the reins of your life. So you learn how to say no to yourself and yes to God.
Amen.
That's when joy really begins to come in your life. And not until then. And as long as you want it your way or the highway, you will never have fullness of joy, the great joy that God has. They didn't just get great joy like that. Hey, they were on a journey of obedience and they were doing what God wanted them to do. And that's what brought them that great joy at the end of the journey. I'm telling you, that's what God has for all who will follow after Him and let Him reign in their life.
Amen.
not only reigning the life, trying to keep it short this morning, but allowing the king to rearrange their life.
Amen.
You read about these wise men. After they left the Christ child, the Bible says they returned another way. They went off on a totally different course. Herod was expecting them to come back to see him. Hey, enough not in your life. We got some other directions from God. And we're no longer following our own wills or what we want. We're following now our God. He has changed us. And how many know when you come into a relationship with Jesus Christ and he begins to speak to you and lead in your life and your life begins to change, it brings you a joy. But so many times we come, we bow, we receive Jesus, we make him the Lord of our life. We say, God, from now on, I'll go anywhere, I'll do anything I want. Whatever you have me to do, here's my life. I'll never forget the first time I ever said that to God. I'll never forget it. I was in a bed. I'd only been saved about 12 hours and I was kneeling in my bed about 5 o'clock in the morning. And as I knelt there and prayed, cried, felt the presence of God, I said, Lord, here's my life. I'll go anywhere. I'll do anything you want me to do. Here it is. He says, I'm going to take you to Africa. I already knew where Africa was. I felt like Abraham of old. Africa. I better start researching this out. I don't know. Where's Africa? What's going on? No, I knew about Africa, Tarzan, all that stuff. I'm thinking, well, I better find out where you're taking me. Then I found out it's 3 times the size of America, and I thought, Lord, where in Africa? For the next 2 years, I prayed, Lord, where? Where? I told my girlfriend, now my wife, I said, honey, we're not going to get married until we know where we're going in Africa. Yeah. I don't want to take the whole journey, but I told her that, didn't I? I said, God first, no marriage plans until we know where in Africa we're going. I don't need to know how, and I don't need to know when. I do know, I need to know where. How at least we have something to shoot for. And so, I'll never forget, 2 years seeking the Lord, waiting on God, asking God to open up the doors to Africa. And we went into a 7-day fast. We was in Bible school. We separated 7 days during the midterm revival to fast and pray. And I said, Lord, all I need to know is where in Africa. What is your will? The third day of the fast, leaving the auditorium after praying at the altars, I says, leaving the mission director came and grabbed me by the arm, took me off to use my homiletics teacher. I thought he was going to talk to me about my last sermon, which went a little too long, which I don't do anymore, but I used to do it before. That was a joke. Only for the new people that are here. I can't even look here. And he said, we have an opening. We have a real need in the country of Sierra Leone, West Africa. We had a board meeting last night, and the Spirit of God was in that board meeting. He spoke to us concerning you and Kathy. And so the board asked me to come and talk to you tonight about being willing, if you graduate, to go to Sierra Leone, West Africa. I couldn't speak, Jerry. My lips quivered. I shook. I just shook. Tears began to flood my face. I looked at the message, Brother Heath. Maybe God, I'll do anything. This is the answer to prayer. Can I don't tell Kathy? She was at the altar still praying. And he said, yes. And I went up and told her, I said, honey, you can break fast now. God has just told us where we're going. We're going to go to Sierra Leone, West Africa. And she's looking at me like, what in the world are you talking about? That was the beginning. That was the beginning of the wise men's journey. Hallelujah. Not only saying, Lord, I receive you. I am ready to let you reign over my life and rearrange everything that I hoped for and sought for and wanted in this life. I lay at that altar. I say, here I am, Lord. If it's to be a palace, it'll be a palace. If it's to be a hut, it'll be a hut. Whatever it's to be, that's what it's to be. I remember the night I proposed to my wife and asked her if she would be my wife to be time to come. Hallelujah. And I said, if you marry me,
I can't promise you houses and lands, or I can't promise you money or anything else, honey. And I drove a brand new satellite, Plymouth satellite. And man, I had nice clothes and everything. I said, all I can promise you is Africa, mud hut, and a rough life. She'll tell you, that's exactly what I said to her. Not quite. I think we'd be sitting on the couch looking at pictures. And we was quietly, I said, you know, life's going to have hard things for us. And I know the journey God's taking on for me on. And if you marry me, this is all we can have. And that night she broke and cried. It was the presence of God. And God spoke to us in a very intimate, personal way. He said, this is the way. Walk ye in it. And 2 years later, we got married. 2 months later, we was in Sierra Leone. And that was the beginning our journey in having a life rearranged. Amen. You don't know what it's like to have your life rearranged until my first 3 days in Sierra Leone. Vomiting, diarrhea, thought I was going to die. I'm telling you, the first rice chop they brought to me, I won't tell you what it looked like, but it was bad. And it looked like manure pile. That's what it looked like. It's exactly what it looked like. It almost tasted that bad. I just went, whoa! And got sick. I mean, I didn't know what was going to happen. And gradually got better, still couldn't look at rice, couldn't even look at rice or anything like that. First 6 months there, just a train, horrible. It was just horrible. The prices, we went to the grocery store to buy groceries. Never forget this. We think it's 30 cents, it was $3. We fill up our cars, we go out there to check it out. Some of you heard the story, but we go in there to check it out. It was $300 and some. We only had 137. That was our salary. So we had to take everything back, put it on the shelves. We realized that 30 meant $3, not 30 cents. We had to recalculate it. We went up there with a couple jars of jelly. Grape jelly and nut jelly, whatever, some of the African stuff that they made there. It was like a dollar, a can of that, and a few other items. And we left the store like, whoa! Bottle of ketchup, $7. 10 ounce bottle. Talking about having your life rearranged. You know how much a pint of ice cream was, Dan? A pint of ice cream, $19. No Dairy Queens. I told God, I said, man, Lord, when I get back to America, I promise you I'll not pass by a Dairy Queen without buying a banana. But I promise you, don't have to worry about that one, Lord. I had to break that promise after. I didn't realize there were so many Dairy Queens. I said, Lord, please forgive me for making that vow to you. I'm so sorry. Life rearranged. You'll never know joy until you allow your life to be rearranged like those wise men did. They went back a different way. They were never to be the same. We sing about it from glory to glory, ever being changed, ever being changed, ever being changed. That's what the walk of joy is. Ever being changed, ever growing, ever becoming more and more like Him, getting closer and closer to Jesus. How many know that Jesus is joy? Yeah. And the more you focus on Him, the more you look to Him, the more you lift up your eyes on Him, and enjoy Him, the more joy you have in your life. And my life, none of all those other things, is just in Him. And my life, and I was so happy, so content, so satisfied. Being in Africa, people used to say, I don't know how you do it. Such sacrifice. And then I said, oh, maybe it's sacrifice. What an honor. What a joy. To serve the Lord in Africa all those years. And don't talk to me about sacrifice. Don't talk about my heart. It's difficult. Hey, for every little difficult thing we went through, the glory that we shared, the changed lives, and all that God has did back then and is doing right now. And the world growing and expanding and moving into 4 or 5 other countries now. And see what God is doing just thrills our hearts to let us know, hallelujah, joy is not in the things that you can possess. Joy is in Jesus. Amen. His will for your life. And I would say there's 3 things bring the joy into your life. And the first one is the Word of God. The Word of God. When you begin to be obedient to the Word of God, I love it. In Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 10, it says, let the joy of the Lord be your strength. But if you read the context, Ezra, the priest, with Nehemiah, called all the people together, and they began to read the Word of
Word of God from morning to night. They began to read the Word of God. And as they read the Word of God, people began to weep and cry and call out to God. And the Word of God began to work in their life. And they began to say, Lord, whatever you want us to do, we'll follow your Word. We'll follow your Word. We'll be obedient. And Nehemiah and Ezra looked at him and he says, let the joy then be, the joy of the Lord be your strength. And the whole context is joy centers in an obedience to the Word of God. You're just learning to do what God wants you to do that's written in His Word. And so He rearranges your life, first of all, through His Word. Amen?
Amen.
And there's a whole lot in there that tells you exactly what He wants from your life. For instance, young people, marry in the Lord.
Amen.
Don't come to me and say, Brother Wayne's really a nice guy. He's the best football player on the team, and he is a great guy, and he doesn't drink that much, and he doesn't smoke a whole lot, and he only crushes a little bit. Hey, I'm just telling you, don't come to me. I'll say, the Word of the Bible says, marry in the Lord. Marry somebody that loves Jesus like you love Jesus. That's why I married my wife. I scouted out the church, and I've seen all kinds of girls there. I scouted up there playing the piano, up there singing, up there worshiping. When they give the altar call, she was there praying or playing, one of the two, the piano. And I thought, boy, pastor's daughter, that's the one that I need. Lord, give me a pastor's wife, daughter. And I got a wife, or got a mom too. I got a double package here. Package deal. But that's what I was looking for. I want somebody that loved the Lord like I loved the Lord. Because I knew it was a radical journey I was going to be on. I wanted to follow Jesus with all my heart. And you better have somebody that has the same desire. You're going to be in trouble. So be careful, young people, who you even date.
Yes.
Be careful. What direction are you going? My grandsons, I'm looking you in the eyes. Be very careful. Grandpa's going to give you some wise instructions here on the steps you're to take in this journey of faith, because you want to be happy. You want to have joy. Joy unspeakable, full of glory. Then learn to obey, do what God says in His Word. But not only by His Word, but by His will. He sometimes doesn't say in the Bible, you're going to go to Africa. You can't read that there. You just don't know what God's going to do. Abraham was going to a country and he wouldn't even know where it was at. And the will of God can lead us in all different directions. It might be to pump gas the rest of your life. It might be to work in a factory. It could be to run your own business. It could be 100 different directions. God, 1,000 different directions. God can lead us on in the will of God for our life. It will be guided by His Word, but His will can lead us in so many different directions and beyond just who you're to marry, but the job you're to take and everything else. It should be a matter of prayer and saying, not my will, thy will be done. And even if it leads me to a cross and I must die, I will die with joy, knowing that that which you have for me is eternal in the heavens, a place that my joy can never be taken from me. Jesus said, I give you a joy that cannot be taken from you, a joy unspeakable, a joy full of glory. He said, I come that your joy might be full. That only happens when you say, Lord, not my will, thy will be done. Joy comes, last of all, closing out my sermon, by His work. Paul said, I have no greater joy, when he's talking to the Thessalonians, than you. You Thessalonians that have come to the Lord through my ministry. You're the crown of my rejoicing. He told the Philippians, he says, you're my glory and you're my joy. I don't have any greater joy than to see my children, all four of them, serving the Lord. And my grandchildren, all 14 of them, serving the Lord. Even if they get an idea that they don't want to, it's going to be very hard to do in our household. And all of them, this Sunday morning, all of them are in church right now, worshiping the Lord. I hope. Doing His will, following His Word. and in his work that he'd have us to do. Whatever it is, just to see what almost every day I get messages from Africa. So they were just in the Gambia. Daniel got called to Gambia to do a retreat, and he had over 150, this is almost an entirely Islamic state, the country of Gambia. He went there, they're doing a pioneer work in the Gambia, 150 leaders that came, and he tutored them for 2 weeks in the Gambia. And leaving the Gambia, he said to me, he sent me a message, he says, "Brother Roy, the Lord has given me, I've had a Macedonian call to Liberia. Pray that the Lord gives the finances for me to go to Liberia. There's a work, we already have a church there, and a booming work there. Even they're on television even in Liberia. It's amazing what God is doing in our work in Liberia." And he says, "The Lord has called me there to minister to those people, and we need funds for the journey there. Pray that the Lord would provide." It's a miracle what God is doing. The structures are going on, the way the church is going, what God is doing. And to see that is a joy. Hallelujah. By our works, we receive joy. He's prepared us unto good works. And as we work for the Lord and we labor, and we see those labors bring forth eternal fruit that lasts forever and ever and ever, I'm telling you, there's no greater joy. As you serve the Lord, realize it's not about just in this life. It's about eternity to come. I want my life and my legacy to live on. And my children and my grandchildren and this church and lives that were touched and helped, encouraged along the way. And to see God doing a work of life. Nick got a little happy this morning, ran all over the place. Hey, if you don't know where God brought him from, where I met him that morning, holding his little child, Jeremy, in his arms, and Caitlin out and playing in the yard, and coming to him seeing he was backslidden, far from God. His life was a wreck. And to see Christ change his life, that was like 18 years ago. Maybe 19, 20 years ago. That's a long time ago. Every once in a while, it gets happy. Yes. Every once in a while, I said, "I can't care where I used to be, where I am today, what I have to live for. It's not in this life, but it's in the life to come." Joy. Joy. Joy unspeakable and full of glory.
Oh, yes.
Great joy. Musicians would come and help me this morning. I really deeply appreciate it. It's like joy like a river. I can't explain it. You can't explain the joy of the Lord. You just can't explain it. There's a strength that comes from it. There's a peace. There's a giddiness sometimes. And sometimes it's with tears. Sometimes the joy comes in some strange, radical ways. I've been in the presence of God going through grief and sorrow, and difficult things, and all of a sudden, a joy. A confidence that God is in control. And no matter what happens, I know even if they hand me on the cross and I believe and die, I can have a joy in God.
Amen.
That passes all understanding. It's a miraculous thing. When you experience, or you know what I'm talking about, it's just amazing. Through the loss of a child, wondering why, and all of a sudden, overwhelming joy comes from God. And you know, when she woke up this morning, she wasn't going to come to church. She was going to go to the nursing home, be with her dad. And the Lord said, "Tracy, you go to church." That's what following His word, following His will. That's listening to God. What did she want to do? She wanted to go and be with her dad. She's been there with him the last several days, continually. But the Lord said, "No, you need to go to church." I love that when God's people obey His word.
Amen.
And so, I admonish you all. Joy just is not some fleeting thing. Following after the loaves and the fish will give you happiness, but it won't give you joy. Following after the signs and the miracles and the frivolous things that this world follows after, and so many Christians follow after something, they die if they could just get a new car, if they could just get a new house, or get this new job, or this, and they strive for all those things. And none of that leads to joy. None of it. It'll be a fleeting experience. I knew a fellow that had a fine home and everything, and all of a sudden he inherited over $1 million.
He went crazy. He used to follow us around when we come in this area. Every church we went to, he was there with his family. You hear our reports about Africa. Followed us. Some one time was seven times, seven services. Every church we was at, there was his family. Followed us to hear about Africa. And he loved, infatuated, supported the work in Africa. All of a sudden, he becomes a millionaire. And I'm going, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. And I was so sad when we came home from Africa to find that he backslid. He was out of church. Beautiful home in the country, out on a Sunday, riding his four wheel, and he didn't come home. And they went out looking for him, hit a tree, and died on his four wheeler. Folks, I'm just telling you, that's not where it's at. The day I follow after those things, the day I've lost my joy. I appreciate my salary. I appreciate the goodness of this church. You have blessed me, blessed me, blessed me. But if God told me tomorrow, it's time to go. Go. Remember when I sat down with the board? Wayne was there. They said, well, how long do you plan to be here? I said, well, I don't know. It took 22 years in the Civil War to get me out of Africa. I almost had a couple of Civil Wars here. Yeah, I'm still here. I'm here until God says it's time to go. Or it's time to step down. Let someone else take over. You just be a peg. Be satisfied to be a door. Don't take Ron's job away from you. So I'm sorry, Ron. You just rest now. You're 85. You need to rest a while. Let this 75-year-old take over, you know. I'm serious. I'm dead serious. Quite happy to say, hey, someone else, take the pulpit, preach the word. I want God's will for my life. I'm not going to try to hold on to a position or power or strength. I'm not that stupid. My joy is in Jesus and whatever he wants, his will, his word, his work. Those are the things that drive me to do what I do. I get just as much joy out of picking up those kids on the bus and the van as I do preaching.
Yes, yes.
I'm serious. It's a lot easier to tell them to sit down and shut up. Then to tell adults to sit down and shut up. Joy. I wouldn't trade this for all the gold, all the frankincense, all the myrrh. I wouldn't trade what I have in Jesus for anything and everything that this world can ever offer me. I mean it all my heart. When I'm laying there in that bed saying goodbye to this world or die suddenly, I want you to know, when I die, I am going to die with joy. Forever. Forever. I shall be with him. Jesus is my joy. Father, take this word. If there's one here that does not know you, one here that's not experienced this joy, one here, Lord, that has not bowed their knee and said, Lord, I want you to reign in my life. I want you to rearrange my life. Lord, I want you to take control of my life. I want you to lead my life. I receive you as my Savior. I receive you as my Lord. I ask you to come into my heart. I'm a sinner and I need to be saved. Oh, Lord, if there's one this morning, deal with their hearts. Let them come to know you. And I'll praise you for that. I'll praise you for that. With every head bowed, every eye closed, would there be one who say, Brother Roy, I need Jesus in my life. I want to be a wise man. I want to follow him. Would there be one say, pray for me? I'm not going to embarrass you. Just raise your hand. I'll see that hand. Jesus will see that hand. Yes. Would there be any others who say, yes, will be others. Yes, yes, yes. This is not about Bethel or Royce Roy. This is about Jesus. Will there be any others? I want you to pray this prayer with me right now where you're sitting. Dear Jesus, everybody pray with me and it will help those that are praying. Dear Jesus, I know that I need you to be my Savior and to be my Lord. And so I ask you to
my ways, of my sin, of my pride, my own selfish ways, and I receive you as my King. I receive you as my Savior. From this day on, I will follow you. I will serve you. I will make you the Lord of my life. Today, my life is yours. Thank you, Jesus, for forgiving me. Now rearrange my life and take me where you want to take me. Prayed that prayer and you meant that, this will be the beginning of something wonderful for your life. You know, I know, 17, and I prayed a simple type of prayer like that. I said, Jesus, I didn't even hardly know who Jesus was at the time. Never had a Bible until that week, that month that I started going to church. Boy, I had never dreamed what he's done for me. Stand, let's sing the Lord with her. If you'd like to come to the altars and pray, especially those who raise their hand, if you'd like to come and kneel before your Maker, seal that commitment to Him, I think that would be a good thing to do this morning. I would love to come by and just pray with you and for you. What's for the elders to come to? I want to pray with Marie. She's going in for some heart surgery. Totally forgot about that. Heart surgery this on Thursday. But we want to pray for her this morning. The elders to come, the ladies. Anyone else too that wants to come? These elders are welcome.
There is a river through.
Faith, I am so sorry that we will not keep you here anyway. Communion next week. God bless you all.
Thank you.